When you're ready. Okay. When you're ready.
I have that pop up.
Oh, fun.
I'm gonna take a drink.
Good choice. Yeah, I'm doing that too. I'm just like.
Okay. Hey, everyone. Welcome to the Cozy Craft Club podcast. Okay, I'm gonna start that over because I almost and I was like, what is the name of our podcast?
I was thinking Cozy Craft Stash, and I'm like, no, that's not it. What is this podcast name? No one knows.
Okay. Hey, everyone. Welcome to the Cozy Craft Club podcast. My name is Kate, and I am coming to you from Boulder, Colorado.
And I'm Amanda, and I am here in South Korea.
And we have a little bit of knitting, a little bit of spinning, and some book and movie talk today. You want to just jump right in?
I think we should. So okay. The only person with a finished object is me. So we'll talk about this real quick. I finished my Firefly wrap, which is a pattern by Pamela Wynne. I knit this in Juniper Moon Farm Zooey in the Arise colorway. Took 5 2/3 skeins, and I'm wearing it right now. It's basically just this nice rectangular wrap thing. Yeah, you can't even see that. So we're not going to pretend. It's a nice open cardigan that can be closed if you were to take, say, like a shawl pin and you do the thing here. Not much to say about it. It's a rectangle with sleeves.
I can't remember. Where were you on that last time we podcasted? Do you remember?
I do not. I remember the first time I talked about it 2 episodes ago, I had like this much. Yeah. And I want to say I had like this, maybe 5 or 6 or 7 inches of it, maybe enough that it was noticeable.
You really got a lot of work done on that in the last few weeks.
I did. I spent a couple days where I dedicated a good 3 to 4 hours a day just knitting on it and watching junk TV is what I did. I tried to finish it up before the tour really got going.
Yeah. Amanda and I have started watching a season of RuPaul's Drag Race together. Yeah. We need to watch a few more episodes of that because I did not knit at all yesterday and I need to take a day where I just like knit for hours and hours on my sweater. Do you have anything more to say about your sweater?
There's really nothing to say about it. It's a rectangle with eyelets around the outside and tubes for sleeves. It's really easy, and I'll try to get pictures of it at some point, but they probably won't be in here. So, you know, if you follow us on Instagram or me on Instagram, maybe you'll see it.
I was going to ask you something and I forgot.
No. Okay. If it pops back in, ask.
So I do not have any FOs, which I was not expecting to have any FOs because I'm being a super monogamous knitter right now, because I am knitting a oversized fingering weight sweater, so it's taking me forever.
Mm-hmm.
I'm making a Boxy by Joji Locatelli, so this is not going to be the most exciting thing to look at because it's just a plain block of stocking net. The color or the yarn that I'm using is Bartlett yarn sport in the light heather colorway, and it's a light pink. Last time we podcasted, I had about 4 inches done on the sweater, and I put a progress keeper where I was.
Good podcaster.
I've knit an additional 10 inches since then. Which doesn't seem like a lot, but there's over 400 stitches on the needle. So a round of this takes me quite a while.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping next time that we talk, I will have, you know, the body of it done and I can start working on the top half.
Yeah. Sleeves
probably safe for last because I hate sleeves. although it's bottom up, so I guess I have to do this.
Yeah, I was gonna say you don't have much of a choice with the construction on that one.
This shows me how much I knit bottom up sweaters, because like I'm so used to doing top up, I was just thought automatically, oh, I can knit the sleeves at any time, but that's not how it works. So hopefully I will not do what I kind of tend to do sometimes with sleeves, which is like I finish the body of the sweater and I get to the sleeves and I'm like, I don't wanna.
And then it's it in the bag and move on to something else.
Yeah. So you've got to hold me accountable on this one.
I can do that. I can be a pain in your rear if you really want me to and remind you to do those sleeves.
I think that when it comes time, it might be helpful to me. So that is my boxy sweater. I'm not even thinking about what I want to knit after this, because I feel like this is going to take me so long if I start dwelling on what I want to knit next, then like I'm just going to lose my mojo on this project, because it's going to take me probably a good...
Yeah, I was going to say I would lose motivation if I started at that point, letting my mind wander to the next project. So I am also knitting a different oversized boxy sweater. I just cast on an outline tee by Jessie Maed. And this is a very boxy rectangular top with short sleeves, and there's a drop stitch detail that goes down the front and down the sides and the sleeves.
It's a really cute detail.
It is very cute. It's based off of her outline tank design, which she then turned into a tee, which it's basically riffed with details is really what it is. I like that though. I like that a lot of her stuff is just variations on a theme and like, look, here's cute other things you can do with it. And so I cast this on 4 days ago, I think. 3 days ago, I don't know, a couple days ago. But because my husband is home and we're watching some TV together, I've got all my ribbing. Plus I just started the body tonight, and you can see where the drop stitches will stop.
Yeah,
but so it's a pretty good size.
Is that color pretty true?
It's slightly more purple. It's kind of mauvey, but it's pretty close. It's a very
such a pretty color. I like that light a lot. Mauve.
And so for this time, this is actually a really inexpensive sweater to knit, because I'm using Berroco Remix Light. I have only two skeins of this, and I think two skeins will be perfectly fine. So this is like $12 a skein at Webs. So it's like a $24 sweater. And so this is 100% recycled fibers. It says it's nylon, cotton, acrylic, silk, and linen. It's really soft with some veggie matter in it, which I think is some of the recycled linen that's in there. And it claims to be a DK weight, but it has 432 yards to a 100 gram ball. So I think it looks more kind of heavy fingering sport, but I'm assuming it plumps up, or they want you to knit it at a slightly looser gauge. You know me, I'm just doing my own thing here. I'm knitting it whatever size I want to, and it's working just fine so far. But I really love the color, and it's a really soft fabric.
So is that a twisted rib at the bottom?
Yes.
It looks really good in that yarn.
Yes. Yeah. It pops out really nicely. Even though this yarn is super nubbly, kind of tweedy, yeah, it still is. It has almost like a chenille-ish almost feel to it. Like it's very soft, and you can tell it's not all natural fibers, but it doesn't feel like a shaved Muppet either. But
I wish I could like reach through the screen and like
squeeze. Oh yeah, the really ball is really fun to squeeze. Yeah, so that's all I've got for knitting for this week. A lot, actually, it turns out. Like, this was like drag race with you knitting, plus my husband and I are watching The Haunting of Bly Manor right now, because he's on leave for the next week and a half, 2 weeks, because he has a whole bunch of time to use or lose. And he's like, you know what? I have a whole bunch of appointments I have to schedule for a bunch of people. His schedule normally is terrible. And so he's taking a couple of weeks off to make sure that all of us get to all of our appointments.
Great.
And do all the things we need to do, because we extended a year, like renew all our rations cards and things that we haven't been able to do because he's never home.
So part of what Amanda and I have been doing since we last podcasted is we've been both spinning a lot because it is the tour de Fleece.
In the summer.
I am spinning on a project that I started last fall.
Mm-hmm.
And I had originally divided all the fiber up to spin for last year's tour de Fleece. It was about a week after I moved here, and I somehow thought like, oh yeah, I'm totally going to have time to spin the entire sweater quantity. I didn't. So I had two bobbins of this done before the tour. So this is bobbin one.
Yeah, it's so pretty.
And this is bobbin two. And I had a little tiny bit of bobbin three, but not very much. So I spun all of bobbin three. I love those colors so much.
Yeah, it's very autumnal.
Totally. And this is bobbin four. So I'm doing six different braids of fiber. All of them are from Hello Yarn. Mm-hmm. And three of the six are actually a bamboo silk mix, which I don't spin a whole lot of, and I've never spun that into a sweater quantity before. So I'm really interested to see how it is going to turn out, but I'm happy with it so far. I mean, the colors are real, real good.
They are.
So how I'm going to do this is just going to be a two ply. I'm shooting for like maybe a sportish weight. I'm just spinning what feels comfortable to me. When I spin, I don't like to get technical at all. I just want to spin what is comfortable for me, and what comes out is what I will be happy with.
Same.
Yeah. So I think today, after we're done recording, I am going to start working on bobbin number five, because I really do want to have at least all of the spinning done by the end of the tour. Can you remember when the tour ends? By any chance?
I got my calendar right here, just a second. I'm on it. July 18th.
Oh, that's like a week away. Okay, so I need to start working if I want to get these two bobbins done by the end of the tour.
Yeah, it's like a week away. Oh my goodness.
And then the Olympics are going to start, and this is what I'm going to be working on.
I was going to say that'll be good knitting for, or TV knitting for you then.
Yeah, definitely. So I've, of course, gotten to see your spin, and it is gorgeous. So why don't you show off what you've got so far?
Okay. So apparently today's podcast is like sponsored by Hello Yarn. Adrian, we love you. You know, if you happen to be watching, you're probably not, but that's fine. So I am doing a Hello Yarn combo spin. I am doing two different colorways, 1.5 pounds, 24 ounces. And I have four bumps of a colorway called Micro Wave, which is a little bit of brown, purples, greens, a little bit of this like blue gray. And this one I think is Tarki, bamboo viscous, and a little bit of tussa silk. And then I have two braids of a color called Inner World, which is Polworth and Tussa Silk, which is like peaches. The same purple is in both colorways. And then it's got some kind of golden browns and some very deep like ink color in it. And so I decided to do this with the sleeve skein, because I'm playing around with the spin a little bit. In the past, I've usually just spun all my singles and then just seen how many skeins, the size of whatever my bobbin will hold, can I get out of the spin. This time I decided to be a little bit more deliberate about it. I decided to take about 13%, 14% of the spin and make it a sleeve skein, where I did thinner strips and I made the sections thinner, so that hopefully when I do the sleeve skein and the body skeins, they will be roughly the same thickness when everything gets knit up. Now, nothing scientific about this. I didn't figure out what proportion I need. I just went, well, if these are a little thinner and those are considerably thicker, things will kind of theoretically even out and maybe look intentional. So I have the sleeve skein done, which I've been tracking the spin every day with a stopwatch function on my phone. You're laughing about it. But, you know, people ask me when I do these spins how long it takes me. And the last time I just guessed on the last combo spin I did. So this time I'm like, you know what? I'm going to time it. And I'm going to tell you exactly how long each of these skeins took me, how long I spent prepping, how much of it was winding time, how much of it was, you know, singles time, how much of it was plying time. So here is the first 25 hours and 59 minutes of my labor. It is 3.1 ounces. That does not include the hour and some minutes that I prepped all the over fibers originally. But yeah, so this is a heavy lace weight, maybe three ply, traditional. This is so much of my life. And I, you know, when people are like, you should sell your hands, but are you going to pay me $300 or more for this skein? Because holy cow. So we're going to put this up a little closer. It is so thin. That is a three ply, y'all.
So I just want to say for the record, before when I was laughing, I was not laughing because you were tracking it the way that you are. I actually think that's genius, and I would love to do that sometime.
Yeah,
to get an idea of like how much time I'm actually spending on a spin. It's more that like you spin so finely that it is just, it's kind of mind-blowing to me.
No, like, and this is my default thickness. Like, this is where I tend to default to these days. It's very comfortable for me. I get into a groove. And sometimes it's practically frog hair. And then I ply it and I'm like, oh, that is thin. And I realize that I am not going to need the full pound and a half for a sweater out of this, because the sweater I knit out of last year's Tour de Fleece three ply, which was about this same weight, the entire sweater with sleeves, I think took barely 7 ounces of that spun up fiber. And it was like a 1300 yard sweater. So it's crazy. So I'm like, ooh, I'm not going to need this full pound and a half. But, you know, I bought this sweater quantity of a spin long before I even knew this was going to be a thing or how much fiber it was going to take. So I'm currently have divided out about just under 9 ounces for another skein, exactly like this, so for the body to match. And then I'm going to ply that. And then I've got lots of fiber left over. Lots and lots. And I'm going to play around with more plies. So I'm going to maybe do a skein of a four ply, and I might do a skein of a five ply, and see how many plies does it take to get certain weights of yarn with how I like to spin my fibers. And if it's enough to do a hat or some kind of a stuffy or something out of it, it'll work. And I figured, if nothing else, it's educational at this point. But yeah, so this is what I've been doing with my time. And then you can see the little spots here where I got to the end, where two of my singles had a few yards left over. So I chain plied it on. So, you know, there's some solid color in here. But yeah, so this is how I spent most of my tour, is on this one little skein of yarn. And I've started
5 hours, so that's a lot of work.
It is a lot of work. Yeah, like I said, last year people asked me and I'm like, I don't know, somewhere between 200 and 250 hours, I think. I'm going to know this year.
Well, I think that's all of our crafting content today, but we did have, we're having a little bit of an RL Steinapalooza
right now.
We read an R.L. Stine book to talk about for this episode, and we've also been watching on Netflix. They've come out with a three-part movie trilogy of Fear Street. They're not really based on any of the books. Like, if you're thinking, like, you know, oh, I hope they have this story from the books, they won't. The first movie took place in 1994. And so I should also say that there's a movie coming out every week.
Yeah,
so,
every Friday.
Yeah. So we've watched the first two.
Yes, together.
Yes, at the same time. We're like texting each other back and forth while we're knitting. The first one was pretty good. It took place in 1994. There was great music. And
The aesthetic, like whoever did the design and decided on the clothing and the teenage girls' rooms and the, you know what, it was so peak 1994, or at least if you were kind of an alterna weird girl 1994, you know, where you were exactly where you were cutting apart all your magazines and decoupaging boxes or notebooks and things to put them in, and you were pasting them on your wall with all your posters of your movies, and it was wild. And like, there's a store that is supposed to be Spencer's in the mall, and the black light velvet posters, man, oh my goodness.
Yeah, that the mall, like it was totally 1990s mall. It was so good.
Yeah.
So basically in these movies, there's a curse. It's a long curse in the town. Mm-hmm. So the second movie takes place in 1978.
Yes.
And I think we both liked the second one better than the first.
The storyline in this one was better.
Yeah. And then the one that comes out next week takes place in 1666. So I'm really looking forward to that. I love an old-timey witch story. And yes. And the plot of this is basically there's been a witch's curse on the town of Shadyside since the 1600s.
Yes.
And these group of 90s kids are trying to break the curse, and it's great. It has a diverse cast.
Yeah, it does.
Although I do think that the first one was more diverse than the second one.
Yeah, it definitely. The second one, the thing I didn't care about it is there was a little bit of kind of like the token non-white kids curse of, you know, the horror movie that happened in the second one. But I didn't know if that was intentional or not, because it felt very Friday the 13th, almost inspired, like Camp Crystal Lake-ish, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, the second one takes place at a summer camp in 1978, and it's great.
Mm-hmm.
So I would recommend those if you're interested in some fun horror for the summertime.
Yeah. Especially if you read Fear Street. Yeah, because like you said, they're definitely not based on any of the specific books. They're almost like someone who really loved the books was like, how can we create kind of a mythos around what exactly is going on in Shadyside? Why is this whole area so full of serial killers and other weirdness? Well, not even serial killers, like mass murderers. We had that discussion too, that these aren't actually serial killers. The things we talk about.
Yeah, I know. It's an important distinction, Amanda.
This is true.
So I loved the Fear Street books when I was a kid. By the time R.L. Stine's Goosebumps series came out, I was just a little too old for them. So I didn't read them. But there was a time period where I was tearing through every R.L. Stine and Christopher Pike book that I could get my hands on. So this has been a fun throwback. And at the same time that we've been watching the movies, we've been reading a Fear Street book
on my Kindle, so we'll just pretend. It didn't even have the cover on it. I was so sad because I'm like, I'm gonna pull it up on my Kindle.
Yeah, the cover is so iconic.
No, it's just the writing there, and they didn't have the cover image on the Kindle file, which made me so sad. I was like,
So I don't know if you noticed this, but in the first movie there's a scene that takes place at the very beginning. It's in the bookstore.
Yes.
Where Ethan Hawke's daughter gets...
Yeah.
So they had Fear Street books out, but they didn't say they were by R.L. Stine. They saw they were by Robert Lawrence.
Yeah.
Robert Lawrence.
Yeah.
Which I thought was funny. So, did you enjoy this book? We actually haven't really talked about this much.
That's because I just finished it a few hours ago.
Oh, okay.
And we haven't had a chance to talk about it because I started it yesterday, because I was like, oh shoot, we're recording. I should probably read that book. So I actually enjoyed it a lot more than I thought I was going to, especially after, you know, the beginning, because I had kind of forgotten how shallow of a character Reva is at first. And I had forgotten that Arlstein didn't do right by teenage girls when he wrote them a lot of times, I don't think.
Yeah, like this book was not, it wasn't subtle.
No, no, they're very two-dimensional trope characters. So like I said at one point, Riva reminded me of basically a soap opera villainess. Like,
yeah, so the plot of this book is that the redhead here, Riva, she's this spoiled rich girl. And her father owns a chain of department stores, and she's working like at a fragrance counter for
just the holidays, I think. Holidays. I think she's helping him out or something. Yeah.
So Reba's a sociopath.
Yes, absolutely.
She's terrible. Like, I was really sad that she survived this, because everything that happened to her, she deserved.
Yeah, I was really rooting for whoever was messing with her in that one. I was just like, she's a terrible person. Like, who actually thinks like this besides a sociopath who's like, I'm bored, I'm going to ruin somebody's life today. Who does this?
No, I know.
Yeah, I was actually surprised. I had forgotten that it follows not just Riva, but her cousin Pam. I had completely forgotten about the Pam story.
Yeah, I didn't remember that at all.
Line in this. So when that popped up, I'm like, oh. Because, like, I kind of remembered the Riva story, you know, because this is probably one of the first Fear Street books I ever read, because it came out in 1991. Mm-hmm. I was 9, so this is absolutely something I would have read. If it came up in my Scholastic reader, I would have absolutely grabbed it. And so it's probably one of the first ones I read. And I didn't even realize the iconic scene that we both remembered with the lipstick actually happens in the first couple pages of the book. Yeah,
it's like the first. So I know it's like the prologue of the book, so I don't feel like it's really spoiling, but Riva's terrible. And so somebody decides to start doing horrible things to her, which go them. And somebody slips a needle into her lipstick. So when she puts her lipstick on, it like basically. I can't even imagine how painful that was, but also she's like making fun of like regular people and calling like women dumpy. And it's like, meh.
Yeah, or if you're a nice person, you're drippy and boring. And she was just like, the other thing I thought is I was kind of like soap opera villainess who would fit in like the cast of Heathers. So like, if you can imagine like the really awful rich Heathers, but like put them in an Arlstein book. I wondered if like that's like what his inspiration kind of was, if, because, you know, she's a very Gen X-y mean girl, I feel like.
I feel like I can't remember the name of the character in The Craft, the blonde girl in The Craft who's a racist, like super terrible and like blonde and preppy.
What is her name?
I don't remember the character, but it's Christine something, and she was married to Ben Stiller. I know that.
Yeah, I know the actress, and she played Marcia Brady in the Brady Bunch movie in the 90s too.
So if you were a 90s teen like we were and you loved The Craft and you know what character we're talking about, it's basically that character, but in a book.
So. Yeah, just very, very bad person. And her cousin just seemed really nice. I kind of felt like he cheats a little bit with writing these books. Like he didn't really, he puts a lot of red herrings in there. Like he creates like, there are like 8 possibilities in here, but I'm not going to give you enough information about any of them for you to figure out what's actually going on. Someone's going to have a wild motivation you didn't picture. Someone who you wouldn't have expected it from. And I'm like, that's kind of cheating, dude. Like
that kind of is cheating.
Because these are supposed to be like teen thriller mysteries. So is it really a mystery though, if you don't get enough information to be able to piece it together?
Yeah. I feel like, I guess they don't really, it says YA on here. This is not really a YA book. This is like a book for maybe 6th or 7th graders.
Definitely.
I can totally see why I loved them when I was a kid though.
Oh yeah.
Like
I gobbled them up and I thought they were the best. And I'm thinking, because now that I think about it, I'm like, he had a very definite formula to how he wrote these. I bet you there's not a single wheel reinvention in any of these books if we decided to go through all of them.
I have a couple more Arlstein books and I have considered like maybe reading another one just to see like,
mm-hmm.
if this is just a fluke because this is a super chiller instead of a regular one.
Yeah.
So yeah, I might read another one at some point, and probably that will be it.
Yeah, I was thinking about it, but like I said, I think he just basically he didn't really put a lot of effort into characterizations. It's just they're flat trope characters in a mystery thriller-ish kind of setting, you know, who's the killer, who's the stalker. And that's probably the thing too, is that I think almost all of them involve a stalker of some sort, which I mean, I guess this was, if you're writing for like 12-year-olds, that is a scary thought of mysterious person is calling your house.
Right. You know, which is like so outdated because, mm-hmm. you know.
I was going to say, because in these days we have caller ID.
Right. But there's things like that that make me think like, well, maybe kids these days wouldn't like these books, but I also feel like there's definitely kids out there who would still love these books, mm-hmm. and they're not particularly, well, I don't think they're at all diverse, but I appreciate these books for what they are, which are books for little gothy tween, probably girls,
slightly morbid, but
like, whoever, yeah, like they checked all my boxes at a certain time of my life.
Yes, absolutely.
So in case you want to follow along and read what we're going to read next, for the next episode, we are going to be reading Bury Me Deep by Christopher Pike. Yes. I know.
I loved him so much.
I did too. I have a feeling that we're probably going to be thinking similar things about those books as we did this one, but
probably.
I'm excited.
I always felt like just you know, my memory at this point is that I think his plot lines were a little bit more sophisticated, and like they were meant for slightly older readers than the Fear Street books. Like I felt like they were meant for more like the, you know, 14-ish, 15 mm-hmm. crowd. So they still weren't adult books by any means, but they had slightly more I'm trying to think of how I want to describe the romantic relationships. They weren't like
more risque.
Yes, I'm trying to think how to say it, because it's like I don't want to be pushing the idea that, you know, the closer or the more physical a relationship is, the more serious it is, but just that there's more, a little bit more physicality to the relationships, whereas this one seemed more like we've been dating for 6 months and we may have kissed or maybe held hands, and it's like, okay, that's fine, you know, but like you said, you know, I think they were intended for a younger audience, so they really didn't go into relationship aspects in the Fear Street books too much.
I will say one thing I liked about this book is it, like, it didn't examine it, but there was definitely like, hey, there's people out there who have less and, you know, they're kind of being held down.
Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely. The whole idea that this one girl managed to have so much control over a bunch of people and their livelihoods and who gets to get a job and who doesn't for winter break. I just thought, how did her father not realize what a terrible human being she is?
I just assumed he was as terrible as she is.
That was the only thing I could assume as well, or he was just completely checked out. I was like, you, why are you leaving all this stuff up to her? Why are you letting your 17-year-old do hiring instead of, you know, I don't know, HR or whoever works for the company who's supposed to be hiring people, even the temps for the holidays?
And because this book is heavy on tropes, unsurprisingly, the main character, Reva, her mom is dead.
Yep. Yep, that's pretty par of the course. Yeah, so
I think that's all we have to talk about today.
Anything else to really say about that?
No. So we will come back to you in a few weeks and hopefully I'll have a finished sweater quantity of yarn by then.
That'd be nice. Yeah, I'd love to see that. I'd love to see a finished spin from you, and maybe we'll both have finished sweaters to go along with that sweater quantity.
That would be pretty well. I'm not going to have a finished sweater at all. This is going to take me a lot longer, but I'm hoping to have the body done, or, you know, up to the armpits body.
Okay, That's fair enough. You know, with the rate you've been going, I think that's doable in the next 3 weeks.
The last 5 weeks, I got 10 inches done, and I only have, I'm at 14 inches now on the body, and I think I have to go to 19. So that's only 5 more inches. So I can probably do it.
I think we got to get some drag race episodes in and have the dates.
Yeah, maybe even after we're done with this.
Ooh, I would be up for an episode. Okay, we can do that.
Okay. All right. See you guys in a few weeks. Yep. Bye.
Bye.